Tiembla Ecuador en la Corte Internacional. El gobierno de Daniel Noboa, presidente de Ecuador, contrató a 4 experimentados litigantes internacionales de Reino Unido, Israel, Estados Unidos y Perú. Ecuador no escatimó recursos económicos para defenderse de México en la Corte Internacional de Justicia, por lo que contrató a 4 de los abogados internacionalistas más reconocidos en el mundo para que lo representen la demanda que el gobierno del presidente Andrés Manuel López Obrador presentó ante el máximo tribunal de la ONU por la toma con violencia de su embajada en Quito el pasado 5 de abril. Por su parte, México envió a la Corte Internacional a un equipo de abogados, todos mexicanos. Está integrado por Carmen Moreno Toscano, embajadora de México ante el Reino de los Países Bajos. Miguel Ángel Reyes Moncaño, consultor jurídico adjunto. Fadia Ibrahim Nader, directora de litigios sobre privilegios e inmunidades. Uriel Alfredo Pérez Márquez, director para tribunales y organizaciones internacionales. Y Max Orlando Benítez Rubio, director para la defensa del territorio y soberanía nacionales. Y recientemente se integró al equipo Salvador Tinajero Esquivel, jefe de Cancillería, Asuntos Políticos, Asuntos Culturales y Cooperación Internacional en la Embajada de México en la República Checa. Liliana Olivia Bernal, encargada de Asuntos Jurídicos de la Embajada de México en la República de Austria. Y Alicia Patricia Pérez Galeana, encargada de Asuntos Jurídicos Multilaterales de la Embajada de México ante el Reino de los Países Bajos, todos ellos integrantes del Servicio Exterior Mexicano. Actualmente siguen las audiencias en la Corte Internacional de Justicia, donde los abogados mexicanos están haciendo un excelente trabajo, presentando pruebas en video y papel sobre este vergonzoso acto que cometió el gobierno de Ecuador. Mientras los abogados contratados de Ecuador carecen de pruebas, y esto es un punto a favor de México. Hoy, el presidente López Obrador, a través de la conferencia de prensa, dio a conocer el avance que se tiene en este asunto.
Señor presidente, en días anteriores se dio una contrademanda de Ecuador hacia su gobierno. Me gustaría saber qué es lo que opina. Bueno, y esto fue a causa y por haber dado asilo al expresidente. Pero me gustaría saber qué opina usted de estos acontecimientos y cómo va hasta este momento, qué es lo que ha pasado, qué avances ha habido, y también saber pues si en algún momento, nos había comentado, si en algún momento va a traer a los diplomáticos de la que estaban en la embajada mexicana en Ecuador.
Bueno, ya los diplomáticos están acá.
Sí. Sí, ya están acá, pero sí los va a traer a la mañanera.
Dices a…
Aquí, sí, a la mañanera.
A la conferencia. Sí, los vamos a traer.
Ok, ¿cómo sí, para cuándo sería?
Pues nos ponemos de acuerdo, puede ser la semana próxima.
Ok.
Que estén con nosotros, que ellos expongan sobre lo sucedido. Y lo otro, pues está… en el Tribunal Internacional de Justicia, y nosotros estamos sosteniendo que se violó el derecho internacional, violaron nuestra soberanía y se violó el derecho de asilo. Eso es lo que estamos planteando, y queremos que se castigue al gobierno de Ecuador, no al pueblo de Ecuador, que es un pueblo hermano, sino al gobierno de Ecuador por este acto autoritario, prepotente, suspendiéndolo de Naciones Unidas, en tanto no ofrezcan una disculpa pública y sobre todo hagan un compromiso de no repetición. Pero además queremos que se establezca un procedimiento que aplique mundialmente para que cualquier gobierno que viole la soberanía de un país irrumpiendo en una embajada sea expulsado de la ONU, que presente el Tribunal Internacional el caso a la Asamblea General de la ONU, que se vote, que todos los países voten y que no intervenga el Consejo de Seguridad de la ONU, en especial que no ejerza ninguna de las potencias, de las cinco potencias que tienen derecho a veto, ese privilegio que es obsoleto, porque no resuelven nada en Naciones Unidas, está como florero, porque todo tiene que pasar por el Consejo de Seguridad y hay cinco naciones que tienen derecho a veto. Entonces, una nación veta y aunque la mayoría de los representantes de los países esté de acuerdo, no pasa. Y eso ya hay que modificarlo. Entonces, eso es lo que estamos proponiendo.
¿Tienen alguna fecha? ¿Esperan algún periodo?
Ya se están llevando a cabo. Resolución. Ya se están llevando a cabo las comparecencias. Ahora que vengan los diplomáticos, nos van a informar. Tiene que estar con nosotros la secretaria de Relaciones Exteriores y nos va a informar sobre el caso. ¿Qué les parece?
¿No ha habido algún acercamiento de para
intentar suavizar? No, y además es un asunto también de principios. Es un asunto de fondo. Es que fue muy grave lo que sucedió. O sea, imagínense que hay alguien que tiene asilo, que entran a la embajada y se lo llevan. Eso es violatorio de todas las normas de política exterior. Y sí, desde luego que nosotros queremos, se han manifestado pues muchos países, dirigentes, pidiendo que permitan al expresidente Blas que pueda recibir el asilo que se le ofrece en México y que sea trasladado a México. Pero eso Lo tienen que hacer, lo deben de hacer. Pero es una parte. Lo otro es, nosotros vamos a continuar con la denuncia, porque ya también es tiempo de poner en claro para qué sirve el Tribunal de Justicia Internacional. También para qué sirve la ONU. O sea, son temas muy importantes. Porque si no, seguimos en la simulación. O sea, y todo es forma y no hay fondo. Son organismos con muchísimos expertos para todo. Pero, ¿dónde está la defensa de los pueblos? Miren lo que está sucediendo con las guerras. ¿Cuántos muertos inocentes? ¿Y qué hacen los organismos internacionales? ¿La ONU? ¿Qué hace el Consejo de Seguridad de la ONU? ¿Vetar medidas para el cese al fuego? Entonces, como que ya basta, ¿no?, de simulación, de hipocresía. Ayer me enteré que les dieron un premio Nobel a periodistas de estos periódicos famosos, y a periódicos famosos, el Pulitzer, sí, pero es, yo digo, Nobel de periodismo. O sea, ¿cómo van a premiar al New York Times? Sí. Fue el que recibió la información de Assange, la publicó y después le dio la espalda a Assange, y ahí está Assange preso y no hacen nada para demandar la libertad de Assange. Y premio. Premio a el medio que con el periodista estrella, uno de los mejores periodistas del mundo, hizo el reportaje de que yo era socio de narcotraficantes. Tim Golden. Donde publica Tim Golden, ese medio fue premiado ayer. Una gran farsa. Es cosa nada más de recordar, para que no se piense que es nuevo este asunto de algunos personajes que han recibido el Premio Nobel de la Paz, cuando ellos han promovido la guerra. Pero eso ya se los dejo a ustedes de tarea, y a los jóvenes. Pero bueno, por lo de Ecuador.
Lo de Ecuador.
Mr. President, honorable judges, it is an honor to appear before you and to present the context of this case, which must be underscored. Your Excellencies, there are lines in international law which should not be crossed. Regrettably, the Republic of Ecuador has crossed them. The actions undertaken by Ecuador not only transverse the established boundaries of international law, but also have served a disconcerting precedent that reverberates across the international community. This very court has stated, in the hostage case, that the inviolability of diplomatic premises is a rule protected by the Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations, which has binding force upon both states party to the present dispute. Moreover, it has asserted that this rule is of a fundamental character. With its actions, Ecuador has infringed upon one of the cornerstones that governs the relationships between states. The Secretary General of the United Nations has taken a stance regarding the matters of the case at hand. A day after the violent and aggressive incursion by Ecuador into the Mexican embassy, the Secretary General released a statement emphatically reaffirming that, and I quote, "The cardinal principle of the inviolability of diplomatic and consular premises and personnel must be respected in all cases in accordance with international law," end of quote. At the core of this case lies not only the egregious transgression against Mexico, but also the legal certainty of every other sovereign state, international organization, and tribunal in the sacrosanct principle that govern the inviolability of diplomatic premises and personnel, a tenet this honorable court has deemed a cornerstone for the conduct of relations between states. The forceful and violent incursion of Ecuadorian authorities into the premises of the Mexican embassy and the unjustified exercise of violence against members of our diplomatic mission, alongside the blatant attempt to justify a grave violation of international law, vividly showcase Ecuador's disregard for fundamental, universally accepted, and long-standing norms. This conduct creates an imminent risk that another violation could occur. A worrisome doubt arises about the true intentions of Ecuador now that the Mexican diplomatic premises and private residences are vacant, with documents and property therein that might be of the interest of Ecuador. In addition, the abrupt and inexplicable change of dynamics that took place on April 4 and 5 deepens our skepticism. Notwithstanding the extensive diplomatic dialogue, including the exchange of information regarding the asylum request of Mr. Jorge David Glass, the former Vice President of the Republic of Ecuador, and even after the declaration of the Mexican ambassador as persona non grata, along with the exchange of notes verbal concerning the request and denial of entry to the premises, diplomatic personnel witnessed a heightened level of surveillance imposed by Ecuador that resulted in the assault of our embassy. Ecuadorian authorities not only breached international law, they exhibit willful negligence that posed an enormous risk to the security and lives of the members of the mission. Had the gun aimed at the Mexican Deputy Chief of Mission been fired, we will now be addressing a far more serious and irreparable violation of international law. The declarations made by Ecuador's authorities after the incident, instead of allaying our concerns regarding a potential recurrence of breaches to the inviolability of our premises and archives, only serve to exacerbate them. While we acknowledge and are mindful of the security situation in Ecuador and of the measures implemented by its government to address it, we remain determined in recognizing that this circumstance cannot serve as an exemption to Ecuador's obligations under the Vienna Convention. There is no rule under international law that could nullify the inviolability of the Embassy of Mexico, and no standard under which the assault could be deemed as a lawful operation. The inviolability of diplomatic premises is even recognized under Ecuadorian law, which explicitly states, and I quote, "Diplomatic premises, consular offices, and those of international organizations, as well as their belongings and archives, will be inviolable and will enjoy immunity against search, requisition, confiscation, expropriation, and any other form of intervention," end of quote. This law makes no distinction regarding acts of authority ordered by administrative, executive, judicial, or legislative authorities. It must be stressed that throughout this ordeal, Mexico consistently adhered to international law. Nevertheless, despite Mexico's compliance, the inviolability of its premises and diplomatic personnel was violated. There is not a valid justification for the incursion that occurred on April 5th, nor for the harassment in the preceding days. Let me be clear. There will never be a valid justification for any breach of international obligations owed to Mexico. States cannot invoke internal dispositions like the measures taken by Ecuador to address its security situation to exempt themselves from complying with their international obligations. This court has the opportunity to firmly reiterate this well-known principle of international law by granting the provisional measures that Mexico respectfully asks for. This case is not only of concern for Mexico. 68 states and international organizations, both at the regional and universal level, have united to express solidarity with Mexico and their disapproval to Ecuador's actions. The international community has lost confidence in Ecuador's commitment and capacity to honor its most basic obligations under international law, raising justified concerns of potential recurrence of similar breaches. Your Excellencies, it is most likely that Ecuador will attempt to justify its disregard for international law and its attack on the Mexican embassy. First, Ecuador might allege that through the protection and eventual granting of asylum to Mr. Jorge Glass, Mexico supposedly violated Article 41 of the Vienna Convention. Second, Ecuador might also argue that the granting of such status was against the 1954 Caracas Convention on Diplomatic Asylum. Mexico will certainly, in due course, provide this court with the information that supports the legality of its decision under international law. However, as clearly stated in Practice Direction 11, adopted by this court, this hearing shall only address the request for provisional measures submitted by Mexico, and not the merits of the case. Distinguished judges, the assault on the Mexican embassy unequivocally constitutes a breach of the inviolability of the diplomatic premises and personnel. No credible and reliable assurance has been provided to prevent further violations, nor has there been full acknowledgement by Ecuador of its obligations to refrain from entering the Mexican premises. Therefore, we respectfully ask this court to grant provisional measures pursuant to the applicable provision of the statute. With the permission of the court, I would ask you now, Mr. President, to give the floor to Mr. Alfredo Uriel Perez Manriquez to present the facts which the request for provisional measures is based.
Thank you. I now give the floor to Mr. Alfredo Uriel Perez Manriquez. You have the floor, sir.
Honorable members of the court, I stand before you to recount the harrowing sequence of events leading up to the blatant violation of international diplomatic law by the government of Ecuador against the premises of the Mexican embassy. These events represent an unfortunate and pivotal precedent that stresses the imperative necessity to grant provisional measures. On the night of April 5th, 2024, Ecuadorian Special Operation agents forcibly entered the Mexican embassy in Quito. Approximately 15 agents and a couple of vehicles raided the embassy. During this raid, our Deputy Chief of Mission, Mr. Roberto Canseco Martinez, was subjected to physical assault while attempting to prevent the illegal intrusion and subsequent apprehension of Mr. Glass, who at the time of the events was under our protection in accordance with both Mexican and international asylum law. These actions egregiously violate the sanctity of diplomatic missions as enshrined in international law. Unfortunately, these were not isolated events, but rather the culmination of a sequence of intimidation and harassment tactics directed against the Mexican diplomatic mission since Mr. Glass' arrival at the embassy on December 17, 2023. Considering the circumstances of persecution targeting individuals affiliated with the political party of former President Correa, Mr. Glass was sought asylum to protect his life and personal safety. Following his formal application for asylum, the embassy and diplomatic personnel were subjected to constant surveillance by Ecuadorian authorities, evidencing a systematic disregard for diplomatic norms. In response, Mexico initiated diplomatic efforts exemplified by high-level meetings between Mexican and Ecuadorian foreign affairs representatives, aimed at resolving the situation through peaceful diplomatic dialogue. Despite these efforts, the situation escalated as evidenced by Ecuadorian Foreign Ministry's request in early 2024 to enter our embassy to detain Mr. Glass, a request our government denied. This refusal was notified by a note verbal transmitted to Ecuador on March 4, which also requested all necessary means to safeguard the integrity and inviolability of the diplomatic premises of Mexico. However, these diplomatic efforts were met with increasing hostility. By April 4th and 5th, Ecuador had drastically intensified its actions against Mexico. Firstly, Ecuador declared Mexico's ambassador, Raquel Serur, as persona non grata. Secondly, Ecuadorian authorities significantly increased surveillance and harassment tactics by police forces in the vicinity of the embassy. All this culminated in the violent events of April 5th. In the morning of April 5th, the President of Mexico publicly requested the support of the Mexican Air Force to retrieve our ambassador in order to vindicate her dignity and guarantee her return to Mexico. Later that day, a press release, Mexico protested the decision to declare our ambassador as persona non grata, as well as the increase of Ecuadorian police presence at the embassy. Additionally, Mexico announced its decision to grant asylum to Mr. Glass and the intention to request a safe conduct to transfer him from Ecuador through diplomatic means. In a press release issued on April 5th, 2024, shown as Annex 2 on the judge's folder, the Ecuadorian Ministry of Foreign Affairs gave false assurances to Mexico, stating that, and I quote, in strict compliance with the norms of the Vienna Convention, it would continue to provide protection to the premises of the Mexican embassy in Quito. End of the quote. However, as this honorable court will note, Ecuador did not keep its word. Up to this point, and albeit the disturbing presence of security forces, Mexico believed that the diplomatic dialogue could prevail. Surprisingly, the Republic of Ecuador deployed a military-style operation in the vicinity of the embassy. And around 10 p.m., personnel of Ecuadorian security forces entered the Mexican embassy without authorization. In the video which will be shown, this honorable court will observe that Ecuadorian agents scale our walls, forcibly knock down the door, subdue the private police officer of the embassy, assaulted our diplomatic personnel, and forcibly subtracted Mr. Glass. Honorable members of the court, as shown in the video, the operation not only entailed the physical assault of Mr. Canseco, but also a significant violation of his personal dignity as he was pointed at with a firearm and forcibly restrained. It is crucial to note what it seems the disabling of communication devices during the raid, a tactic that points to a premeditated effort to isolate our staff during these critical moments. As these events demonstrate, the raid was carried out in a violent and premeditated manner. Although there were only unarmed diplomatic personnel in the embassy, Ecuador decided to deploy an operation with tactical and military-style equipment with long firearms to subdue whoever was necessary. This also demonstrates Ecuador's capacity and intention to carry out this type of operation whenever they deem it necessary bypassing the norms of international law. In light of these severe violations and the sustained threat to the safety and dignity of our diplomatic personnel, Mexico was compelled to break off diplomatic and consular relations with Ecuador. As a consequence, our diplomatic premises are empty and unprotected from any actions Ecuador may take to re-enter, inspect, seize, or damage Mexico's property and archives. Ecuador's actions demonstrate its disregard for international law, which is why Mexico is turning to the court to request provisional measures. This, Your Excellencies, concludes my presentation on the factual background to the present dispute. I am grateful for your kind attention. With the permission of the court, I would ask you now, Mr. President, to give the floor to Ms. Liliana Oliva Bernal, who will present how this court has prima facie jurisdiction in the present request.